it gives us some of the tincture. You can also mix it with a little bit of honey. Pretty amicable. I've seen Grindelia honey, where Grindelia flowers when boiled up in honey, steeped for a while. Only problem with that is like you have to like take a razor blade and cut a hunk out. The stuff sets so hard. And you don't want to thin it out, because if you thin out honey, this sort of acts like gelatin in honey. It makes the honey thick. One thing you can do is basically roll little balls of it. It's almost that hard. And then just roll in some something pleasant like licorice root powder, or if you don't mind the fact that there's not a lot of it anymore, slippery elm powder, marshmallow powder, something like that. Just roll it in that and just suck on it. That's an option too. But if you ever do make a Grindelia flower honey steep, just be aware that it makes it, it's like STP crankcase additive at 40 below zero. You basically have to take a pair of shears to cut it, and you walk, you know. So you can almost make little honey drops out of it, as long as you roll it in something and don't pack them too tight in a jar. Put them in a refrigerator or put them in a cool place so they don't sink together. The rest of the time, Grindelia tincture, Grindelia tea, or probably the best way is to put a couple of squirts of Grindelia in a little bit of hot water, add a little bit of honey, a little bit of peppermint, steam it up a little bit and cool it down, drink it that way. Although just scarfing down a squirt is itself adequate. It'll get you expectorating pretty quickly. It also is a acid urine disinfectant. Another good, sensible use for it. And let's say Buku from South Africa is a little bit on the exotic side, you know. It is. Buku leaves. And juniper berries have a distinct limitation of consumption before they irritate the kidneys. This won't do it. This does tend to act as a urinary tract disinfectant and anti-inflammatory. If you take the tea, you can just take the dry plant, make a tea, put the tincture in tea, but drink it in like a cup of water. Drink it in a volume of water. Average dose will be 30 to 60 drops or one or two squirts. Or a handful of the junk boiled up. It isn't bad tasting. It's sort of waxy bitter. Hard to explain until you do some. And do it every 3 or 4 hours. Do a good stiff cup of it. Keep after it for a couple of days. Acid urine or sexually transmitted infections, even if it's just, you know, a Christmas go home, binge, and be nervous thing, and the same old chlamydia as always comes up again, it's still an acid condition. And this is good to back it down. It also is anti-inflammatory to the mucosa. And it's sort of a cheap, local substitute for calendula, since it contains similar constituents and will stimulate cell proliferation. It's an endothelial cell proliferant stimulus, if that makes any at all sense. I could restate that, but it probably wouldn't help. It has some of the aspects that Grindelia, that the calendula is famous for, to stimulate endothelial proliferation, regranulation, and get you through birds and stuff like that. It's also, unlike calendula, a little more anti-inflammatory. Sort of like a mixture of calendula and chamomile. And it grows here. No one uses it much, but it should be used for that purpose. There's several of the sticky DYCs that are really pretty reasonable substitutes for calendula. Okay?
It's antiseptic, isn't it? Is that
yeah.
What you were saying?
It's anesthetic, or at least mildly anti-inflammatory. It cuts down on pain. And does stimulate endothelial cell proliferation. So it speeds up topical healing, wound healing, and it does inhibit bugs. It's not a big one. It's not its main function, but you know, most waxy, raunchy plants are going to kill bugs. That's what they do it for. You know, this is a durable, semi-xerophytic high mountain plant. It survives really cold weather. Okay. This here is valerian. Everybody know valerian? Who hasn't had a chance? We're missing people. No, we're not. I have to get used to this. I have to drag around 28 people for 3 weeks. At 4,000 miles, what would it end up being?
No, I ducked out of the... Remember, I came back early.
That's right. Bad carrot. Well, anyway. This is, like, so easy. So, like, this is valeriana. Okay, now everybody knows valerian, huh?
No, I don't even...
Huh?
Not what it looks like.
Well, there's valerian. Oh, thank you. You saved my ass. I suddenly have a function again. Yeah. Here. Oh.
Is it so easy?
It's right there, yes. It's poor. Gotta carry that chair down, man. She's gotta carry it up again. Oh, well. This is probably valeriana. Acuta loba or diversa loba, or that's good enough. It blooms in the spring, and in fact, several of these will have the flowering pieces are right there. This was a valerian flower. Okay, but it flowered and it went away and it is no more, but maybe it had some babies, and meanwhile the basal rosette continues. My experience has been that the western munchkin slope basal leafed valerians are stronger than any of those elsewhere, except perhaps the ones from India. But Indian stuff grows so strong, forget it. But valeriana fish, huh?
You said from India?
There's an Indian species, I think it's valeriana wallachii, I don't know, that you sometimes see in commerce amongst Ayurvedic folks. But that's evil stuff. That's really evil. The usual is valeriana officinalis. Everybody grows it faithfully. It's a big plant, it's got big roots.
And it's different looking, isn't it?
It's much larger. It's halfway between this and another one we'll see later on, which is valeriana edulis. Where do we see a lot of it? Oh, that was up in La Junta Canyon. Oh, well, we'll see a lot of it elsewhere. No problem. This is strong stuff. I've always thought it was considerably more potent than commercial or organically grown, faithfully duplicated European valerian. You know, why does it have to be better from Europe? Just because that's the valerian that has all the research on it. You know, the research will make it whole. And that's because herbs are used in Europe pharmaceutically, and so there's the money to study. And there hasn't been any much American research on any of this stuff in the last 50 years. Occasional exceptions. Anyway, this is really strong stuff.
Do you tincture the whole plant?
Yes. My preference would be to do the whole plant fresh.
And when would you do that?
Right now.
Mm-hmm. Right now?
Okay. Yeah, after it's gone to bloom.
We're here,
yeah. If you want it really literal, hot summer days, I have found the plant to be strongest. I'm not that fussy. I've even got it when I've had to, when it's sort of in bloom. But it's really weird. In bloom, the roots are so much feebler. It'll bloom in late April, early May. Okay. It sometimes blooms when there's still snow on the north slopes of the same area it's growing in. But in the heat of summer, and then late August, I mean late fall, are probably the peaks. But if we are here in September, I would say September's the best, you know. I'm really not to be trusted on these.